Next up is training session, Mr. Jarrard.
Madam Chairman, members of the Planning Commission, it's a pleasure to be here with you again. It always is, actually, I may think I'm sort of strange, but very weird to be in front of y'all and just have this opportunity to train. I really appreciate being asked to come back. I run the gamut when I prepare this of trying to balance between wanting to give you enough of what you want, but also not being so long-winded that you absolutely wish I would shut up. So if I begin to carry on or go into something that you have no interest in, just please tell me. I want to make this relevant to you. I will tell you that Mr. Brown was kind enough to give me sort of a list of some of the topics that he wanted me to go over. And so that's what I'm going to do, is go over those topics, but that's not means anything else is off limits. If we have anything else to discuss as far as a part of the training exercise, I mean, let's discuss it, and we can do that. And so I'll be happy to go down any rabbit trail y'all want to go down. But let me start with the first one, and just we'll go through it. So on my little cheat sheet that I got, the first topic that we were going to talk about was Planning Commission duties. Planning Commission duties, very broad categories, you might suspect, and I suspect you also know where I'm going to go immediately when we talk about Planning Commission duties, and that is I'm going to go straight to the Unified Development Code, because Chapter 4, Article 3 of the, excuse me, Article 2 of the Unified Development Code sets forth your duties. But I thought we'd do something kind of unusual tonight. I thought we might just very quickly go through them. Because, you know, until you set and actually look through them in a while, you sort of almost forget all of the duties that our code authorizes you all to fulfill. So again, I don't want to make this boring, but it's just some sort of neat sometimes just to sort of walk through them.
Chapter 3, what?
It's Chapter 4, Article 2. Chapter 4, Article 2. And it's got a nice sort of concise statement of your duties. As with any other committee or authority or agency in government law, you all are creatures of limited jurisdiction, as is the Board of Commissioners, as is the Development Authority, as is any other entity. And you're basically constrained by whatever the enabling legislation is that creates you. And in this situation, it's sort of this. It's the UDC Chapter 4, Article 2. So let's go through it very quickly. 4.2.1, with respect to the comprehensive plan, Planning Commission shall prepare, review, and recommend a long-range comprehensive plan to guide the future development of Forsyth County. Number two, the Planning Commission may prepare, review, and recommend to the Board of Commissioners for its adoption small area development plans for identifiable areas where more detailed guidelines are provided to supplement the objectives of the plan. Number three, Planning Commission shall prepare and recommend for adoption to the governing authority of the county, basically the board, an official zoning map and zoning regulations for unincorporated Forsyth County. Number four, the Planning Commission shall prepare and recommend for adoption to the board subdivision regulations for unincorporated Forsyth County and recommend perfection and amendment of those regulations. Please feel free to stop if at any point you say, you know, what are we talking about there? The Planning Commission may prepare and recommend for adoption from time to time to the board a plat or plats or an official map showing the accurate location of the boundary lines of existing, proposed, extended, widened, or narrowed streets, public open spaces, or public building sites, together with regulations to control the erection of buildings. I don't know that I've ever seen the Planning Commission actually utilize that authority, but hadn't visited with it in a long time to know it's there, but it is.
Does that conflict with state laws?
I don't think it conflicts with state laws. It's recommendations. It would be subject to state laws for sure, okay. But I don't think that it would directly conflict. Okay. Next one would be the Planning Commission through the director may make, publish, and distribute maps, plans, and reports and recommendations relating to the planned development of Forsyth County to public officials and agencies. I gotta tell you, that's a fairly broad power. Again, just read it again. You may make, publish, and distribute maps, plans, reports, and recommendations relating to the planned development of the county. Who to? Well, they would go to public officials and public utility companies and civic, educational, professional, and other organizations. Once again, sort of embedded in your powers is this terribly, you know, potentially terribly important power.
Would that be like an overlay district?
It could be more than that, but it could be that. Yes, but I think, I mean, a 4.2.6, which is what we're talking about there, I hope you're in your UDC, to me almost carries with it almost sort of a, almost an educational component to it. Reports and recommendations, and when you look at who the actors are that are supposed to get those, civic, educational, professional, and organizations, to me that's almost you and your sort of advocacy of the planning process to these outside agencies and trying to educate them on what planning looks like.
Could part of that be maybe like limiting the number of apartments and stuff in Forsyth County, looking into that and studying and releasing a report on it?
I think that's right. I mean, I think that that's right. I think it does anticipate collective action. It does talk about the Planning Commission doing those sorts of things, and it does indicate approval by the board, but it clearly is talking about reports and recommendations of this body with anything that may impact planning, apartments or infrastructure or environment or, yeah, all of those things. And I think it's purposely broad. It's meant to be broad because in many respects it's meant for you to fill the gaps of what is needed. That's the way many laws are drafted. You know, we don't know exactly what we meant when we drafted it, but we figure you'll figure it out as part of your duties.
That's another way of us helping the Board of Commissioners and giving them some ideas, I think. Is that right? I was saying about the apartments or something, we can come up with some ideas and pass them on and sort of help the Board of Commissioners make their decisions and give them some ideas that they may not think of.
Well, I mean, if you look at 4.2.3, going back to zoning, the Planning Commission shall prepare and recommend for adoption an official zoning map and zoning regulations. Now, I know that you all think of that in the context of when we have a text amendment to the code, you're one of the entities that will pass upon that, but it could be construed a little broader than that. I mean, it could be construed just as making recommendations generally on text amendments. The only caution I give you, though, is it is a collective process. It's it's you collectively acting together to take action to say, this may need some looking into, this may need some review.
Yeah.
Help. Here's how we're helping you, Board of Commissioners.
So you're saying that we need to have a vote, send that up, rather than a particular individual from the Planning Commission contacting or speaking to the commission?
Well, you don't forfeit your right by serving on an entity to individually petition your government. You don't forfeit that right. But to the extent that you want the strength of the Planning Commission behind you, there is no accommodation within these rules for individual action. It's all collective action. All right. 4.2.7, public hearings and recommendations. This is the one you're probably most familiar with, that you all are the public hearing branch of this local government for many of the things that we have public hearings for, with respect to not only text amendments and zoning maps, but also rezonings and also conditional use permits. That's probably the power that you wear the most often, and it's the one that you spend your most time doing. 4.2.8, variances. The Planning Commission is authorized to consider and make recommendations regarding variances subject to the limitations of the code. 4.2.9, the Planning Commission, through its secretary, shall keep and maintain minutes. We'll talk about minutes and sort of what that looks like and maybe how we can make sure that process is as good as it can be later. And then finally, with respect to additional powers, the Planning Commission shall exercise any other powers or duties as provided to it by law, not otherwise delegated to the department by this code. So sort of a catch-all, I will tell you, I don't read a ton of power within that sort of catch-all just because it says your powers are limited by law. And the law is most limiting on your powers is this code. That's the primary law that limits your power. So I've sort of gone through, but make no mistake, within 4.2.1 all the way down to 4.2.8, there's a lot of meat in there. And it'd be kind of a neat thing to sort of revisit it. Every lawyer I know will eventually crack open a code book and find something they've never seen before, even if they've been practicing for 20 years. Sometimes you just miss stuff if you haven't gone through there and looked at it again. So just sometimes nice to go through it again. Any questions about that? All right. On my cheat sheet, the next thing I had was, what sort of considerations are you all supposed to take into account when you are making your decisions? Well, not surprisingly, it depends in no small part on what you are making a decision on. For instance, let's say that you are passing upon or making a recommendation with respect to a text amendment to the Unified Development Code. UDC 8.4.3 addresses that. It says, amendments to this text will be made only if they bear a substantial relation to the public health, safety, morality, or general welfare. May not have known that. Candidly, I hadn't dusted that language off in a while. But that is, in fact, that's the way a local government justifies the exercise of its police power. And so that's really not crazy or novel language. That's very standard language, but I had forgotten that it was actually in the UDC at all. And it is. And so when you are passing upon a text amendment, we'd like to change the UDC to have this new language in Chapter 8 or this new language in Chapter 10. When you're back in your mind, you're thinking, now what do I apply as part of my decision-making process? Well, does this text amendment bear a substantial relation to the public health, safety, morality, or general welfare? Okay. Pretty standard stuff. Still kind of neat. All right, with respect to zonings and cups, those things are set forth with specificity as far as your considerations in Chapter 8. And in fact, and I think we've gone over this before, so I will not be redundant on this, there's actually a laundry list of not only general considerations, but also special considerations. So, if you look at the general consideration, it says things like, the fact that there is already ample land in the requested classification shall not of itself justify denial or approval. Again, just some sort of things to bring to the table. The mere fact that a certain zoning classification is in effect at the time property is acquired does not preclude the new owner from seeking a new classification. Have we ever heard at a public hearing or something, you bought that knowing what the property was zoned, if that's ever occurred? That's actually stated right there in 3, the mere fact that a certain zoning classification was in effect at the time the property is acquired does not preclude. Now, that also means it can be raised, but it doesn't preclude it. It's a factor, it's not dispositive.
Ken, you're starting the list on 8.8, page 8-12.
No, I'm sorry. Forgive me, I was sort of rattling on. Yes. 4, no threat to the safety or morality of the citizens of the county shall be found to exist from a commercial development of land alone. Again, I had not thought about that language in a while, but that's in there under general considerations. And again, you may say, what are those, Ken? Just sort of backstops that are supposed to sort of guide your decision making. The Board of Commissioners has adopted these backstops, and you are supposed to at least consider them when you're making your decisions. Number 5, the disposition of every rezoning shall be made on the facts applicable to that particular case, considering the merits of the land in question, the impact of a decision upon the landowner's property rights, and the legitimate interests of the community. All of those things are supposed to be considered. And they are fair considerations. The property owner has rights. The community has rights. Your job is to bring all of those considerations to bear. And then, of course, framed against those general considerations are special considerations. Now, these are the ones that you probably camp out on the most. These are things like the projected densities. What is the comprehensive plan or the future land use map say about this zoning? Whether or not the applicant's proposal is in conformity with the policy intent of the comp plan. Whether or not the applicant's proposal will permit a use that is suitable in view of the uses and developments of adjacent and nearby properties. That's why in the tech review, a lot of times the first thing you'll see is here's what the property around this property is zoned. That's lining up specifically with a special consideration you're supposed to consider. Whether or not the applicant's proposal will have an adverse effect on the usability of nearby property. I'm not going to read them all, but you understand they're there. And again, so when I get a question like, what are the considerations I'm supposed to bring to bear with respect to a zoning or a conditional use permit? Go to the code. They're creatures of law. This commission is a creature of the UDC and needs to bring to bear the considerations articulated by the board. Not only the special considerations, but the general considerations as well. To me, if you were to frame it, the general considerations are sort of the foundation of the pyramid, the big overriding public policy arching goals, and then the special considerations sort of get more focused and focused and focused as you consider them. Does that make sense? The big policy objectives and then the more limited specific objectives. Okay. All right, so those are my considerations with respect to you making your decisions. And there's a lot of them, so I'm not going to read all 50 of them, but there's a lot of the special considerations.
I was curious, is there a source of where those came from?
That's the reason why I'm asking, is I wonder if there's state law that applies in other places that helps to set precedents.
Well, you know, there's the Steinberg Act, but the Steinberg Act doesn't apply here, and I don't think it contains, in any event, all of those special sorts of considerations.
I think five,
but not 50. And
it was the Steinberg Act has something to do with population.
It does.
Is that correct?
That's why it's not. That's right.
So, well, it did. It was actually repealed because the Constitution didn't allow
density-based or population-based rules, but that was a big deal when it was in effect, to sort of these are the guiding touchstones for these larger scale municipalities. But in the meantime, I don't know, Tom, I mean, as far as any particular source for all of these considerations.
No, the five, special consideration B, II, A through E is pulled from close to that Steinberg Act, and the rest are just things that have developed over time in the ordinance.
If you look at them, I mean, there's nothing within them that jumps out at you as like, I cannot believe we consider that as part of a land use decision. I mean, they're all, I mean, things like floodplains, soil erosion, pollution, utilities, sewage disposal, water supply, consistency with the sewer master plan. I mean, all of those things are considerations. Now, do I anticipate that each of you have gone through and done a mental checklist of each and every one of these every time? Maybe you do. And I think that many times your staff review is going to address most of those. I think that's the point of it. So.
I was curious about that because I know a lot of those things, you know, floodplain could definitely be an issue, but there's also the UDC regulations that they have to comply with unless they're asking for a variance. There's state and federal law. And there's a number of laws that protect those following zoning a lot of times.
And if you look at B, special considerations for decision, look at the first two words there. You know, it says as appropriate. So when you see language like that, as appropriate, who is that vesting discretion in? Well, you, because you're the ones that are the recommending body, and you will determine what as appropriate is. Now, how will you make that determination? Probably because staff are going to give you a lot of guidance that these are, in fact, things that are implicated by our review of what's in front of us. So as appropriate, but again, it does vest you with a little bit of discretion.
Let me ask this example then. Say that there's a property that has a substantial amount of floodplain on it, and in the zoning side, there's not adequate information for us to know if there's going to be, you know, all sorts of compensation that's required, or, you know, that everything's going to be constructed. And if we decided that, and we said that based on the fact that there's too many issues with the floodplain, that zoning, we'd recommend denial of that zoning ended up being denied, and then there was a lawsuit and it was based on something that, provided that someone complied with all the laws, wasn't a fair basis. And you see what I'm saying? I mean, there's already like a law there, so I just was trying to figure out if what in a court situation, is that a weak or a strong argument?
Well, it would depend. I mean, the typical rule is going to be a balancing test. I mean, that's the rule set forth by the courts. There's typically a balancing test based upon what is the impact on the person or entity whose property you declined to zone. Whenever you decline to zone a piece of property, there's going to be a burden or impact on the individual that you said no to. There's typically, when you say no, going to be a benefit to surrounding property owners or to the community as a whole. Many times what the court will do is we're going to say, we're going to balance that. So the burden you have imposed upon that property owner, what is that burden? And then what is the attendant benefit to the adjacent or the community as a whole? And do they match? Or is the burden you have placed on that single property owner much greater, significantly greater than any benefit you have given the balance of the property owners? That's sort of the balancing test. So to the extent that you decided, given particularly that you're authorized to review floodplain and generally environmental considerations and impact on adjacent property owners, what if in fact, adding to your hypothetical, there was actually information provided to you during the public hearing or even in the record that the zoning that is being forwarded to you will have an impact that will diminish the value of the floodplain, therefore diminish the value that it has on water quality, and therefore the impact on adjacent property owners could in fact be significant. Well, I would be willing to go to the court on that. On the other hand, what if the fact is the floodplain's de minimis, they've got all sorts of evidence of credits where they've mitigated elsewhere, and therefore there would be, you know, you could content yourself, there would be very little impact, either because they've made up for it elsewhere, or because the amount of floodplain to be impacted was just too small. You see, I mean, there's not like a magic answer. It's a balancing test, and it's going to be what? It's going to be many times, it's going to be very factually driven. That's the bottom line. But is it a fair consideration to think about? Absolutely.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but it's my understanding that in discussing or coming up with a recommendation, or even the Board of Commissioners coming up with a vote, that we're not supposed to take into consideration whether there's going to be a lawsuit or not. It's my understanding that consideration of a lawsuit should not enter into effect of whether we should be making our decision. You know, I've heard people around say, well, we really better not do that because we might get sued. And it's my understanding that that's not right.
Right.
Can you weigh in on that, or am I?
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that's a fair question. I mean, should litigation dictate your land use? If I can frame it that way just for a second. Litigation dictate your land use? Should the threat of litigation dictate your land use? The answer is no. The threat of litigation should not dictate your land use. Now, when the governing authority, if they have a concern about potential litigation and they want to speak to me privately about it, am I going to give them some guidance? Yes. Should it be necessarily guiding your recommendations? No, not really. Every zoning you're going to have in front of you is probably going to have a constitutional challenge letter in the file if it's being done by lawyers that do this a lot. It's not meant to be overly adversarial. It's not meant to be offensive. It's simply meant to comport with the law that says that if you don't raise certain constitutional challenges at the time or before the decision is made, they are waived. That's what that's about. So it's not an attempt to say that every time there is a zoning and there's that letter in there, that therefore a threat of litigation should guide your land use decision. Because if that was the case, if every time you got one of those letters, you said, oh my goodness, this says that if we don't take this action, it's going to be illegal, you'd approve every one of them, right? And that's not the rule either. Now, I will tell you that if I was approached by a client of mine who said that they have a 3-acre parcel surrounded by heavy industrial that is a sewered parcel on a major arterial roadway, and we want to go ahead and deny the zoning and keep it agricultural, here's what I would tell you. Fine, if you want to exercise your legislative discretion in that way and not adopt that zoning, but if there is a lawsuit, this county or this city or whomever I'm representing will likely lose. Because if it's surrounded by industrial property and it's sewered, and it's on a major roadway, it's going to be very difficult to argue to a court that that property ought to stay agricultural. Let's go back to our balancing test. We'd be telling that property owner surrounded by industrial, we want you to keep your property good and ready for crops, while we've allowed everyone else to maximize the yield of their property by putting that nice industrial development there. And the property owner's going to say, and the burden you're placing on me is grossly disproportionate to any benefit derived by these surrounding property owners. Does that make sense within the context of the what's called the Gould balancing test?
So if we have a legal question about something that we're doing or voting on, should we
see me?
I was going to say, see you, or see, should we discuss it with the developer's attorney? You know, or is that
right?
You understand what my question is? I don't want to get. We've got the developer's attorneys in here, and I'm not wanting to step on their toes, but I'm trying to clarify.
I'm sure they
Where we're supposed to go.
I'm sure they would understand if I said that if you seek legal guidance, that talking to me about it would be more.
So we should seek legal guidance from you rather than.
As long
should
as I'm.
Be first, probably speak
because
to
you're our attorney.
Well, yeah, I mean, right. Well, I mean, if it's a question that Tom's comfortable answering, and he's comfortable answering a lot of them, then certainly. But to the extent that you know are concerned about something that you believe really gets into the weeds, I mean, Mr. Brown and I have a relationship. He's more than happy to direct you my way if he is the least bit uncomfortable answering it, is what I have found. But yeah, I mean, as long as I'm a county attorney, which, you know, what time is it? I'm still okay. I still am. It's always.
So we shouldn't seek legal advice from outside of you.
Well, I think what I'm going to tell you is that I have an ethical obligation and my bar license on the line to provide you guidance. How about that?
Is that? I just want everybody to understand that.
That's my job. Okay. All right. Any event, good discussion. I mean, those are good questions, and I hope my 3 acres of agricultural surrounded by industrial was a gross enough, crazy outlier example to sort of show what that balancing test looks like. And framed that way, you kind of get it. I mean, that makes it kind of easy when you see, you know, you're asking me to keep my property all pristine, everybody else gets to maximize yield, then it makes sense. Of course, the questions that you all are faced with are never that easy, are they? That's not the question you get,
right?
And that's the way it works.
Just one last question on in the general considerations where it discusses the impact of the of a decision upon a landowner's property rights.
Which one? Just which
this happened? This is number 5, balancing a landowner's property rights and legitimate interest of the community.
Yep.
What defines the landowner's property rights? There's nothing in the UDC itself, right? That's more by the state and U.S. constitutions.
Well,
or
yeah, well said. I mean, that's going to be one of those amorphous, you know, what is the general public policy on property rights in Georgia? And I will be the first to tell you that property rights in Georgia are, you know, somewhat in favor of Georgia property owners. And that's why there's some rules of construction on how things are looked at that benefit free and open use of property. Now, that doesn't mean we can't constrain it by way of codes and things of that, and we do. We do constrain it, and these are fully enforceable. But, you know, the public policy is this is all sort of at odds with the free use of property. So, for instance, you will hear it before, and I was actually going to reference it in the next section about zoning conditions. If there's ambiguities in things we do, whether in here or whether in zoning condition, guess who gets the benefit of the doubt? Property owner who's trying to use their property for whatever purposes that they want to use it. Well, that's nothing other than a manifestation of the public policy in Georgia that says we're a pretty pro-property owner state, pretty pro-property owner state. So, but no, you're right. There's no definition of what that means. And that's the sort of thing where if you have a question about it, ask me. I mean, I know you would, but I'm just saying, ask me. That's what I'm here for. So what does that mean exactly? And I'll be happy to tell you in hopefully more sophisticated language offline once maybe I can provide you some case law. Okay. All right.
Please. I'm not sure how to frame this, but we're appointed.
Yes.
And we're not elected. that sort of gives us an advantage over elected officials, that we have a bully pulpit and we don't have to worry about being elected for what we do or re-elected for what we do or say. We're responsible to the commission or to the board that appointed us. My question is, with that in mind, are we, from reading some of the books on planning commissioners and stuff, are we sort of a rep, it's my understanding that we are a representative of the people. We're not professional, supposed professional politicians, so we are a representative of the people, and we're supposed to be the people's voice to the commission to help make a decision, help them make a decision, okay. As opposed to being a developer's voice. Now, that's something I've struggled with, and I imagine most everybody has. Do you,
well, I, here,
do you see the distinction I'm trying to make there?
Yeah, I see the distinction you're making. I'm not sure, I would necessarily frame it as an either-or, the representative of the people versus the representative of the developers. I mean, at the end of the day, the people have elected their district commissioner, and then they have, in fact, appointed you. I fully agree with you that in your appointed capacity, there is a certain autonomy and liberty that perhaps you have insulated from the direct election process that gives you sort of a wider berth to act. I'm with you on that. I think that's true. With respect, though, to who you represent, I've struggled with that question. I've talked about it with some of you before as to who you represent. At the end of the day, the best I've got for you is, I think that is based upon the understanding that you have with the commissioner that nominated you. In other words, what is your vision for me on this planning commission? And I'm not sure it's going to be the same for each of you. I mean, I don't mean to get in the way of that, but I'm just saying my experience has been some of you may have relationships with the commissioner that appointed you that may be different than others. And again, this is not directed at anybody, but you know, one commissioner may say, you go free agent, you vote whatever your conscience dictates, I don't want to hear from you again. As long as you don't get me in trouble, I'm happy. Another one may say, I want you to carry and be the representative of my vision on that planning commission. And I'm not here to tell you either one of those is illegitimate. I'm just telling you they're different. I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, that explains it to me. Thank you.
Okay. It's not addressed in the UDC, so I'm just...
Well, I asked the question.
Yeah, it's not. All right. Conditions. Again, I don't mean to be moving fast, but I know you've got a lot of work to do tonight. So, conditions. Are they legal? Good Lord, I hope so, because we impose a lot of them. So the answer is yes, they are legal. Conditional zoning is legal in Georgia, but I suspect that's not why this was on my outline. I think you all understand they're legal. They are and can be challenging conditions for a couple of reasons. And you know, Tom and I and Vanessa, we've been here a while, and certainly I have seen my share of conditions that had given me sort of a cringe moment. I don't mind telling you that. A couple of things. Let me just give you some what I think are the easy pointers. Number one, if we can do it, please, let's don't have conditions that mimic things that are already in our laws. Inevitably, what that leads to is confusion because the condition won't quite match what is in our regulation, and then you have sort of two operative documents that say almost a little bit of a different thing, and that can be confusing.
Can I ask a question about that? There have been times when I put a condition on a zoning application or whatever,
yes, sir,
that is a condition that's in the UDC.
Okay.
The reason that I would do that is the UDC can change. And if I want that condition to be there for sure, then you have to duplicate it. Otherwise, when the Board of Commissioners change the UDC, then that condition is no longer on that. Can you
Yeah, let me go into that, because this is a good time for me to talk about, just that specific issue. Here's what I was getting at. There used to be a practice in the county that we would have like this stock list of standard conditions that would go on every zoning, and they were all, every time it seemed like they were absolutely duplicative of UDC, and it used to drive me to distraction that we would do that. And the commissioners were absolutely wed to them. They loved them. I think, Commissioner Moses, what you're talking about is a situation where you are addressing a specific condition that may be redundant to a specific provision of the UDC, but you think that condition needs to be there irrespective of the fact that it's redundant with the UDC. Not, I've got 19 conditions and they're all redundant to the UDC and by gosh, they're going to go on every one of my zonings. You're making a specific decision on a particular zoning based upon the facts. I don't have a problem with that. I was talking about more of this situation where, just to show numbers, how many conditions we put on there, you have a lot of conditions that do mimic the code. That was my bigger concern. Now, I don't have a huge problem with that at all. I think that's okay. I will say this, the conditions, though, are supposed to address, the legal standard would be, they're supposed to ameliorate or lessen the impact of the zoning. That's the reason you can do conditional rezoning, is to lessen the burden, to lessen the impact of the zoning. So when you're fashioning your conditions, or you're working with the owner or property owner or developer to come up with these conditions, in the back of your mind, what does this condition do to impact, lessen, mitigate, diminish the impact of this land use on the community and the surrounding property owners? Okay, that's one question. Secondly, let's keep our conditions as best we can in the realm of those things that are legitimately enforceable. I have seen conditions where the county had no more a chance of enforcing that condition against anybody than we just don't have the resources to do it. Candidly, it was a very minor issue. You know what have you ever seen that before, Tom, where you like questioned the ability of the county to legitimately enforce that condition? And again, don't get me wrong, there may be a hard case that comes up in front of you and you believe that maybe if code enforcement may not catch it, but an adjacent property owner might, and they may call code enforcement. I think that's okay too, because the reality is some of our code enforcement effort here in the county is going to be complaint driven. That's just the way it is. And so I think that's okay. But I have seen some conditions were sort of like, how many angels can dance on the head of a pin, where there's just no way we're going to legitimately be able to enforce it, would be my only caution. So if you have a question.
I have a question. When you're talking to a group of homeowners, as an example,
right,
and they want certain, they're asking for certain conditions that you know are in the UDC, and they haven't always been in the UDC, they've been added to the UDC now.
Right.
But people, used to put them on as conditions, but these people want them on there. How do you handle that?
Well, and again, that's sort of a hybrid of Commissioner Moses's question, which is what the Board of Commissioners giveth, the Board of Commissioners can take it away in the context of the UDC. And so if you want to make that rule or regulation part of the actual zoning map, which is what you're doing when you're approving a zoning, then go ahead and add it in there. And if that, of course, in many instances dissipates the concerns of the surrounding property owners, then I'm not going to have a problem with that. However, I do think it might stand to reason that we could at least explain to the neighbors, look, this is in the UDC, this is the law of the county, and whether I put it in there or not, it will be enforced, subject only to the point that in the future it could be removed.
I have a question, just because I've tried to struggle with this a little bit about what the role there is. A lot of times, when we're talking about conditioning, we frequently get in a role where we're almost mediating. And mediating, even though you're mediating and working with individual people, somebody has opposition, just do what they say and they're going to be okay. But if it's not really advancing the general welfare of the public or improving upon that condition, then is that really our role to be a mediator in those circumstances?
Okay, a couple thoughts on that. We know we started with the notion of what are zoning conditions supposed to do, and zoning conditions are supposed to mitigate or diminish the impact of the zoning, the land use, on adjacent property owners or the community. So, to the extent in your situation, it is in fact those adjacent property owners that are coming to you and saying, we want this, we want that, we want that. To those property owners, it probably feels like very much that what they're asking you to do is a condition that will lessen the impact of that zoning on them. That's when you have to say, do I believe that or not? Now, do you feel like you're mediating? Probably. And I got to tell you, that's, you're right. You are mediating. But I think so long as you can frame it as being a legitimate exercise of mitigating the impact of that zoning, I think that's okay. I think that is a role that you play. I'm very comfortable with that.
To follow up on that, I thought about that right there, and I think at the very base level, that's what planning commissioners are. We are mediators. We kind of help both sides kind of come together. And that's what we should be doing. So at the very, when you funnel it all down, we're mediating disputes right there and passing on a recommendation so that then, you know, and our mediation doesn't necessarily carry any weight, but it does, it could if the Board of Commissioners wanted to. And so we can listen and hear people and mediate, and they can let off the steam, and as well as the developers can come in and we can, you know, mediate, and they can let off some steam like the people. And then it's our job to mediate.
Sure, and of course,
that's the way I see it.
And it may happen that you, in fact, are trying to mediate over a condition that, in fact, the other side will not agree to, which is also part of the mediation process. You know, the whole point of mediators is two people, or a mediator is that two parties may not necessarily agree on everything, and that of course is where that autonomy from being non-elected can come into play as well, is that you can sometimes take a bullet and take a hit and maybe give some bad news that someone that's elected may be more reluctant to give.
There's some instances where things that are asked for are unreasonable, and I think you need to say, that's just unreasonable. There's no way that can happen, but perhaps you could do this.
Well, and that gets to what the question was, is if you believe it has no semblance of or no resemblance to actually advancing the public health, safety, or welfare, and that's exactly, I think, what you're talking about, that kind of a condition where you just feel like that's way out of the box, then I mean, that's the sort of thing you need to call, you know, Vanessa or Tom or me about and just say, you know, I'm being asked to sort of add this as a condition and I'm uncomfortable doing it. And, you know, and again, I do this that a lot of times that I speak, I say this, you know, be confident in your instincts. I mean, if something seems out of line or out of sorts or just not comfortable or not appropriate, chances are it's not. Chances are it's not. I mean, there's nothing magic about this. If someone comes to you and is asking you to impose upon somebody else something that absolutely makes no sense, whoever it is, if it's the developer asking you to do something and or you're uncomfortable with that, or if it's a property owner saying, I want you to sock it to those guys and do that, and you just say, you know, this doesn't feel good to me. It doesn't feel appropriate. And that's when you can take this blessed liberty of being non-elected and say, you know what, here's my answer. With all respect, the answer is no. I'm not gonna send that up the path. All right. Number three, my little cheat sheet here. Conditions should be clear. And I know that you're saying, you know, this, I came to a training session, you could tell me conditions should be clear. But many times these conditions are being worked on right up until the very day or afternoon of the meeting. And if I was to tell you what the great Achilles heel of local government is, it is rushing haste. Truly, local government makes waste. We're just not good at it. And so I will tell you that I would ask you, when you read a condition, read it as if you have no clue about all the stuff that you, in fact, know all about. In other words, read it as if you're a stranger to it. Because if it doesn't make sense to you, it probably won't make sense to us when we're attempting to enforce it later. So I just ask that conditions need to be clear. And going back to my statement of the public policy in Georgia. Remember what it is. If there is a rule or regulation that attempts to impact or diminish the free use of property and it has been imposed by the government and it is ambiguous or unclear, guess who the courts are going to give the benefit of the doubt and construe it in favor of? The property owner. So if we adopt an unclear or ambiguous zoning condition, it will probably not be subject to enforcement. Okay. That's challenging for us. Okay, that's really all I had on conditions. The next topic I had was how to make motions, or the more precisely, I know you all know how to make motions, but the accuracy of motions. I will tell you that making motions is terribly difficult, particularly in the land use context. It is easier to say, I make a motion that we approve this contract, second discussion, no discussion, please vote and vote. That's easy. Making a motion on a contract is easy. Making a motion on a zoning is a little more challenging. I mean, I know you're making a motion to recommend, the Board of Commissioners making a motion to adopt, but the reality is, saw it just the other night, you've got a motion to approve a zoning, and then you've got conditions that's displayed, and I've got two here that were just handed out to me, and then I've got this one that's on this map right here. I want to include that one. And unfortunately, that can become a bit of a jumbled mess in the record. And the problem is that many times these motions that you're making are part of the deliberative process. In other words, you're making the motion literally while you're attempting to address maybe concerns that fellow commission members have raised. And so each of you, when you're making the motion, know exactly what you're talking about as you're attempting to make the motion. But unfortunately, what are motions distilled into? Black and white text. And sometimes that black and white text, you don't capture sort of the essence. Now, if you were to say, okay, well, Ken, what's the magic bullet since you do it so well? I'm sure the Board of Commissioners never makes a motion that has to be clarified. Well, that's not exactly true. They do, and of course, I will tell you, I'm sitting there, and many times I get caught up into it, and I know exactly what they mean, and then I will look at the minutes later that Sonia drafts, and I'll just be having one of these, you know, moments where I'm sort of lowering my head going, it's not her fault, it's my fault. It's my fault. I didn't catch it. Or I was too busy attempting to make sure that something other was caught and it wasn't caught. So making motions in the context of zoning is challenging. I would tell you, if I could, with any sort of, and not be considered a hypocrite, I would say draft them all beforehand and have them ready to read. That actually is the clearest way to do it, is to actually have your motions written down. And if you actually have your motions written down and have the conditions already ready in advance, that's perfection. Okay, that's the way to do it. I know it doesn't work that way in the real world sometimes, and I know particularly on disputed or controversial zonings, when you're literally trying to capture maybe fellow commissioners' points in your motion, it's easy to then get bogged down, and the problem is you lose clarity with that. All I can offer up to you is to say, use best efforts.
I've talked with Pam about this, and she's told me, you know, we're not supposed to make up our mind before the end of the presentations, and we talked about having it kind of written down, but it's open to change anytime somebody says something.
Well,
you know, so you can write it's a when you say write it down, that's just the beginning of that being in flux.
Well, that's a fair point, too, Commissioner. I think what you could do, too, you know, because I know what you're getting at, honoring the notion of make your mind up at the public hearing. Yeah. You could have a draft motion to approve and then your stock motion to deny.
Yeah.
That's a real easy one. That can be up there right in front of you.
Well, I've had motions that I've written out before and actually thrown them away because during the public meeting, mm-hmm. I've had my mind completely 180 degrees changed. So when you do write it down, I think that you need to be open. You know, that's not your final say. That's just the beginning.
And that's just a recommendation. I mean, again, you know, it may not be practical or feasible, or that just may not be something you're prepared to do. I'm just telling you, if you wanted to ensure that the motions sound good, sound reasonable, and that the clerk can actually put them down, writing them out is a pretty decent thing to do.
I think, Ken, too, one issue that's come up recently is just that if they are written and you're reading, to speak them as written, because they'll be recorded as to what you say. And also, too, if a motion includes something different than the request, the motion will be recorded in the minutes and not what was requested. So I know there's been confusion or questions about that when the motions have been recorded.
Is there a specific way, I mean, I know in one of them I had approved and then I had denied because I was trying to, you know, I want to keep that discretion there. I read both of them. Is there a way to actually correct what you say? Like, should you say, you know, I was just like, wait, I didn't mean that. But should there be a way that you correct that more formally? Or does it? Can that be informal?
No, I mean, that can be informal. I mean, here's okay. the trick. If you make a motion and are you saying in, you know, mid-sentence you just get it wrong and just, I mean, there's two, if it's before a second's made, I've certainly seen folks say, you know what, this is not going well. I'm going to start over again. And I think that's perfectly fine. I'm going to clear the decks and we're going to start over again. Once it's been seconded, technically the motion belongs to the body. It doesn't belong to just the individual. And that's why you'll see, will you withdraw your second? I withdraw my second, therefore I withdraw my motion. Let's start over again. But if you're just in the middle of making it, you are the master of your motion. And so I think you have every right to say, stop, time out, this is not going well, I'm going to start over again. Just do it there.
That's pretty much what you did. I mean, you said, no, I didn't mean that. I meant, and then you restated it.
Yeah, that's fine.
Go ahead.
I was just going to ask, too. I know there's one tool that we don't use very often in our, once a motion's made, are amendments to strike or add. Like, you know, say that there's a motion and all of the conditions were fine, but one person did not want one of those, or was fine with the motion except for one of the conditions. Mm-hmm. Can you go over just the procedure on how to amend that? Would that be like after the motion is made, does there have to be I think there's a second, and then somebody else can make a motion to amend that by either adding or removing, and then you would vote on that?
That's correct. So you have your main motion with all the conditions. Well, let's say it's the conditions as displayed on the screen, which is a standard one I'm used to seeing. So you've got your motion with the conditions. Second, now you know by the second that now that motion is the body's. It's the agency's motion. And that's when the other member says, well, I would like to make an amendment to that motion to either clarify or modify condition 8. I move that condition 8 read not 4,500 square feet, but 3,500 square feet. Second, and then of course discussion, then let's vote on the amendment to the motion, vote taken. If it's yes, that vote passes, now you've got on the table, you've got a main amended motion that has been moved and seconded that is now up for final vote. And that's the way it works. That's very common.
Just like we did with the agenda.
Just like what you do with the agenda. Y'all did that exact process on your agenda.
I don't think I'd seen any amendments. I didn't know if it's...
I don't think we've done any amendments to conditions.
The only thing that I would caution you on, it's a modest caution, is if you attempt to, I've seen a board attempt to defeat the motion on the floor by way of an amendment, and I won't allow that. I think that's out of order. You can tweak a motion, you can try to make a pending motion better, but you can't defeat it altogether by way of an amendment. Okay. The way you do that is during the discussion time, you try to talk your fellow members out of it, and that if they will vote it down, then you make your motion to defeat or to take the other option. All right, with respect to, that's all I have on motions, and I wish I could give you more and there'd be some magic bullet I could give you that would make all of, but the reality is that's challenging in any, whatever the agency is, whether it's the Board of Commissioners or the Planning Commission or the ZBA or any entity that I know of, making clear, concise, perfect motions is challenging. The minute adoption procedure. I think this is something that, you know, Vanessa raised with respect to some specific minutes, and I know that we in this assembly have gone round and round with respect to that procedure as well. So I don't know if there continues to be a pending issue or not, but let me just offer this up. We do know that there are going to be a draft of your minutes. We know that's going to be issued within 48 hours of the actual meeting. That's the draft. That's called the summary that has to come out under the Open Meetings Act. And then we know that the minutes themselves are supposed to be approved at the next actual meeting of the agency for which action was taken at the prior meeting. So that's when the minutes actually get approved. At some point, you're going to receive a draft of those minutes, and the expectation is that you're going to review the draft of the minutes. Why? Because you want to make sure that, at least to the best of your understanding, they reflect what actually occurred at the meeting. Now, to the extent that you get that email and you provide edits or you provide comments back, I'm okay with that. There's nothing wrong with that. You can provide your comments back. Now, here's the reality, though. The comments back need to reflect and be indicative of what actually occurred at the meeting. I've said it once, I'll say it again. Minutes have one purpose and one purpose only, and that is to accurately capture what occurs at a meeting. They're not for redos, they're not for clarifications, they're to accurately capture what actually occurred. So in the era of audio and video cameras, with so many of these meetings being recorded, there shouldn't be a whole lot of guesswork as to what exactly happened at the meeting. So my only caution to you would be is that if you want to comment on what the minutes look like, it needs to be a comment in a way that is simply saying, I think that word needs to be changed to make the minutes more consistent with what actually occurred at the meeting. But I'm fine with that. We learned the hard way some time ago that with respect to what you're finally going to approve on the minutes, let's have it up in front of you so it's right there and can be viewed. I like that. I want that. I want you to have that in front of you. If heaven forbid, that you actually have a version of the minutes in front of you at the meeting that you do not believe accurately captures what occurred at the meeting, raise it. Yes, sir.
I have two comments on that. Number one, the minutes that we've been getting lately are excellent. And I'd like to compliment Vanessa on what a nice job. It's a lot more thorough, and we can really see, you know, they're a little bit longer, and they take a little bit more time, and it costs a little bit more money to get them together. But I certainly appreciate it, and I think it's really nice. Another caution that I've lived through, and I just want everybody to understand that if the video and what actually happened was somebody said this is black, but if the minutes say it's white and you've approved the minutes, it's white regardless of what you actually said. The minutes are the be all end all, and that's why they're so sacrosanct.
And that is actually what happened with this last instance from when I was at the Board of Commissioners meeting this last Thursday. What the minutes reflected is actually what was said. That's not actually what was meant, because it was contradictory to something up above, but that is what was stated when the motion was read.
So. And you have a chance to change, you have a chance to clear that up before you sign the minutes. As you said, but once the board has approved the minutes, you can change them, I think you've told us, but it's a big process and it's not something you don't take lightly. So it's regardless of what was actually said, what's on the minutes.
That's right. So yeah, two things you've raised. You've raised one situation where the minutes, something happened at the meeting and the minutes reflected something else happened at the meeting. Those minutes, once they're approved, the official record, for instance, in a courtroom, is then going to be those minutes, and they reflect something inaccurately. That's bad. I want those minutes changed. And we know what happened, actually, because that meeting was videotaped. And so we know we can go back and change those minutes. That's not where I want to be, though. I want my minutes to reflect accurately what occurred. The more common scenario that I had to deal with the Board of Commissioners not very long ago was when the minutes, as typically, they spot on identified what occurred at the board meeting.
Yep.
Just what occurred at the board meeting was a mess.
That's what
and the and the minutes were spot on captured the messiness of that. And so we did a clarification, not of those minutes, because the minutes were accurate. Everybody with me? Just, they reflected a mess.
Yeah.
We did a clarification of what everybody intended.
Yep. And that's what happened for us the last time, which is what Vanessa and I had discussed.
Yeah.
And so my recollection of what had happened was not really what had happened, because the intent was for a certain density, but what was spoken was something different.
Got it. Perfect. I mean, I think this commission probably more than any, at least you get minutes. I mean, you know, we've hoed this ground before, and so I appreciate the comments. I appreciate all the comments, because I know we've done this before. I know you're in good hands. The next point I had was site plan credentials. I just wanted y'all to know, to the extent you don't know, that is something that Mr. Brown and I took to the Board of Commissioners and have received specific directions with respect to modifications to the UDC on site plan credentials. So I'm not going to go into that. That's going to be something I, in conjunction with Tom's office, are going to be bringing back ultimately to you. You will have a bite at that apple, because that's going to be a text amendment to the UDC. Board of Commissioners was very willing to address that. You'll get it in the way of a text amendment and can make a recommendation on it. So I promise you those issues are going to be addressed. All right. Questions posed to PC members during a public hearing. All right. So you're at the public hearing, and members, citizens come up to speak at the podium, and you ask, I want to make sure I get this right, because there's two rules here. You ask those members, or those citizens, questions. Okay. First of all, do you have the authority to ask citizens questions? Yes, of course you do. You have the right to ask them questions. They have their ultimate right, of course, not to answer if they choose not to. There's no one's under subpoena here. They have the right to not answer your questions. I've never seen that occur before. They likely will answer your questions. But I would say, what is the objective of you asking questions? And I will tell you that it depends upon who is in front of you. If it's the applicant to the zoning, you may have a whole slew of questions that will better help you understand the technical aspects of the development, or the land use elements, or potential challenges with respect to that zoning. All sorts of questions that you might have. If it's a neighbor stakeholder, let's say it's an adjacent property owner, your questions may be different. It's not going to be, what are the technical challenges of the build out? It's going to be, tell me about how this may better impact you, or you got up and raised some very serious concerns about water quality. Could you help me out? I don't understand. Could you tell me what's really going on? My point is simply this. When you ask your questions, I would ask that you ask the questions as a tool to gain clarity with respect to the issues that are before you. I don't mean that to be so obvious that you're like, well, of course, can we get that? I mean, I'm not going to ask them questions about the weather. I understand that. But I would say it's a public trust that you have, and I think that we have an obligation to therefore ask them questions that are linked to the public service that we're filling. I don't have anything to say that you're not doing that. I'm just saying that would be my statement to you. I think that when any agency asks questions of members of the public that are considered disrespectful, and again, this is not for any situation in front of you, I'm just giving you my typical guidance on this, that are viewed as disrespectful or brusque or harsh, I would be careful about that, simply because, you know, we're the government. My Board of Commissioners is the government, you're the government, ZBA is the government, we're all manifestations of the government, and the public expects to be treated a certain way by the government, and should expect that, to be treated a certain way by the government. So whenever you're interacting with citizens, and literally you're in your station up there, and in this position of at least perceived authority, and they come up and want to interact with their government, I think that to the extent that there's any even hint of advantage taken of that situation, I think at the end of the day, we look bad. Again, there's no particular issue I'm addressing here. I'm just saying, be mindful of that. And I've seen other governments, not this one, I've seen other governments do that and didn't come across real well.
I'll comment that our chairman is really good with that. and she kind of leads the way for us and sets a good example with how much respect you show to the people. And so I tend to think that's probably part of your job, maybe, is to lead by example. And I would compliment you on that, and I imagine Ken would too. So,
absolutely.
You know, we can learn a lot by watching the way you handle it.
Well, I think that's right, and I think that there is an expectation, and sometimes governments get it and sometimes they don't, but we ought to be able to take a good time lashing. We ought to be able to take some harsh criticism, and that's just the way it goes with government, because it's who we are. And, you know, I think we ought to approach it that way, that irrespective of how anyone else behaves, we're going to be civil, we're going to be decent, and we're going to be respectful, because that's who we are. Now, the other side of that equation is what happens when the public asks you questions. All right, now I'm going to go there. I'm going to go down this path. First of all, that is typically going to occur during the public hearing section. So they will have come up, and perhaps they're coming up to make a public statement or a public comment. There is no obligation by the Planning Commission, any entity, Board of Commissioners, unless your bylaws specifically provided it, or unless the rules specifically provided it. But within the confines of my address to you, there's no obligation for you to respond to those. Now, you're not rude. Most of you will try to. But I will say that if you get into a give and take and begin to allow that to become a sort of a free-for-all question and answer period, I think that there is a perception that that's inappropriate. I would caution against that. Look, the public hearing is exactly what it's for. It's to hear public input. Some of the worst, most uncomfortable situations I've seen is when I've seen a agency member and a member of the public sparring at the podium. It leaves me uncomfortable. It's not a fair fight, and I don't mean that to suggest anyone does not have the mental or whatever faculties to engage in it. I'm just saying you've got a member ensconced with all the regalia of the government sitting there going at it with a member of the public, and the government just never comes out looking good in that situation. I'm sorry, that's just my perception. Secondly, if you get into the situation of answering questions, what happens when the really tough one comes your way?
Or if you give a wrong answer.
And you choose not to answer it, or can't answer it. You then set yourself up to either look A, squirrely, or B, incompetent, or C, both. Let's don't do that. I mean, so again, I'm not trying to suggest that you can never engage, and sometimes it is appropriate, and you sort of know those when you see it. When it is appropriate, it's a benign question. Maybe I've seen someone at an alcohol ordinance hearing, or when we were trying to do something, say, you know, when does my time of discontinuing alcohol sales start? A very fair question, something just very, you know, procedural, and we can get addressed with that. But I've also seen situations where I thought that the question and answer back and forth just was very close to getting out of line. If you are feel like, you know, an answer to do, it's a fair question, but I really don't want to start this give and take, a very fair thing to say is, you know what, I've got staff, they are going to take a note of that question right there, they're going to write it down, and they're going to provide you a response back. And that's a very reasonable way to, one, indicate that we understand our citizens are asking us a question, they have every right to expect an answer, but I'm not going to get into a discussion with you, I just don't know that it's appropriate at this point. Okay. All right.
I like that too, honestly, because sometimes we get a question that's a tough one to answer off the top of our head. What's the property across the street zone? What's their density? Things like that. We don't always have that information at our fingertips upstairs, and with something with 10 minutes of research down here, the next day we can collect easy. So
that
works for us. Don't feel like you're dumping any work on us by doing that.
Yeah, and the biggest trap I ever face is when I answer something I don't know the answer to. And there's a lot of pressure sometimes when you get a question like that to come up with an answer, because the perception is you don't know what you're talking about if you don't. But the reality is one of the best answers you can ever give is, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. And I have a tendency to defer to staff, which is then putting them on the spot right then instead of doing what you just suggested. So that is a good suggestion.
Well, I try to defer to Tom when he has a question. Mr. Brown, what's your thought on that constitutional issue involving?
As we sent him.
That's where I'm from. that's where I want to camp out. All right. Finally, the last topic I got was, or the last one I'm going to address before we get to training funding, is meeting efficiency. Meeting efficiency. And I grappled with that when I was sort of coming up with my outline. So let me give you a really good legal answer for that one. First of all, the definition of efficiency is in the eye of the beholder. The language itself is just indicative of a concept that two very reasonable people may reasonably disagree on what that means. One person may view efficiency as very little questions, very streamlined approach, very quick meeting. And another person may view efficiency as procedurally appropriate meeting, a lot of discussion, a lot of debate, a lot of discourse, but I thought the meeting was efficient. And I say all that to say there's no magic bullet. My experience has been, I do this in a lot of places, my experience has been is efficiency is a product of the culture of the agency. And you're an agency, you're a board. It's a product of the culture. It's something agreed upon. There is a jurisdiction in this county that I think all of us would agree is very efficient as far as very quick in and out. But some of you may think there might be a different way to have those same sort of meetings. Do you all have an agreed upon, quote unquote, culture? I don't know that you do yet. I think some of you may view how this interaction as being part of the Planning Commission is different. And I think those differences of opinion are very reasonable. There's no way I can sit here and say, here is the one thing you need to know, and your meetings will be efficient. So let's assume for a moment, just for right now, you've not coalesced to the point that you all have this just common understanding of what an efficient meeting is. Let's assume you don't have that. Now, are there some procedural things you can do to sort of, not force feed efficiency, but to start sort of really prioritize efficiency? Yeah, there's some strategic, there's some procedural things, calling the question, motion to limit debate, motion to put a time period on debate. All those things are parliamentary devices that are aimed at trying to streamline and focus the discussion to get to a result. But you know what? I have seen many jurisdictions that have rule books as thick as they can be, and yet those governments are very reluctant to use those devices. And the reason they are reluctant to use them is because typically the recipient of one of those devices feels like it's an attack or a slight on them, and most of the agencies are reluctant to sort of, you know, drop the nuclear weapon in the middle of the meeting. So what I will say to you is then efficiency is in the eye of the beholder, and the quickest thing, well, there's a couple of options. Number one, if you want efficiency, maximize what you do at your work session. Maximize what you do at your work session, because if you feel like you're getting into the regular meetings and the meetings are going on endlessly and there's too many unanswered questions and things are unclear, it's probably because some of the heavy lifting wasn't done around this table. Now, it may be unfair of me, but that would be at least one thing I might offer up to you. You know, if you want to talk about some additional procedural tools to try and guide that efficiency, we can do that. But I think the better thing to do would be to exploit the work sessions. And I think the other thing to do is it's going to come as you coalesce as a commission. As you work together more, as you come together more, you may go through tough zonings more, almost like an esprit de corps that will sort of accompany you. And I think that's going to lead to efficiency as well. Yes,
sir. Kind of following up on that, I'd like to commend my fellow commissioners here for putting up with me from time to time when I get going. And I think that y'all have all been mighty kind, to let me speak sometime ad nauseum. I'm working on that and I'm trying to shorten what I say. But up to this point, I feel like that y'all have treated me very, very fairly and given me time to do that. And I'm gonna try to respond in kind and be quiet. Not be quiet, but not go on and on like I'm known to do. So, but I just want to thank you all. This is a good opportunity to do that.
And that's it. Yes, sir.
Can I get you to weigh in on one of my favorite subjects? is you'd think I'd know what my is conflicts of interest. Okay. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, with respect to zoning actions, you know, conflicts of interest. Well, there's two things we need to keep in mind, and I think we've discussed some of this previously, but I'm happy to go over it again. I think with respect to conflicts of interest, we've got the zoning procedures law contains specific safeguards with respect to a conflicted vote. Typically, with respect to things, if you or a family member have any sort of a financial or personal interest in the matter that is coming up before you for zoning action. I mean, you're supposed to announce, you're supposed to provide a written document evidencing that you have a conflict, and you're supposed to recuse. We also have in Forsyth County, we have an ethics code, which is actually more broad than just the zoning procedures ethics rules. And it basically says, I can't summarize all of it in one little sound bite, but it basically says that if you are considering taking action on a matter where you cannot make an objective, neutral, and unbiased decision based upon either a personal affiliation or a financial affiliation, then you should not take that action. And you should again announce, and you should recuse. And you know where I stand on that. I hope all of you do. And I think that you need to give those considerations full play in every zoning that comes up in front of you. I think most of you try to do that. The ones that I've had encounters with and experience with, I know that you're trying to do that, and I know that the Board of Commissioners attempts to do it as well. But they're serious, and a conflicted vote in a zoning matter can actually render the entire zoning void, invalid. Just something to keep in mind. There's plenty of case law on that, and I think I've used this analogy before, but typically ethics is sort of a bright line. And no one ever fell off a cliff 30 feet away from the edge, right? So you try to keep back a little bit.
Can you have a conflict of interest if you don't know that you got a conflict of interest? Can you have a conflict of interest without knowing that it's actually a conflict?
Well, the whole I'm going to answer the question, but let me get out my explanation. The whole point of a conflict of interest is that because of the relationship or the financial interest or what have you, your ability to make an impartial, neutral, and objective vote fulfilling your civic obligation cannot be taken because you are making your decision based upon what? Something other than your civic duty. So if you don't know you have a conflict, you don't know, wait for it. If you don't know, can you be guilty of an unethical act if you didn't even know enough to be able to take that sort of a conflicted decision? You would think the answer would be no. But I think at the end of the day, the better approach is that if you have a conflict, and even if you weren't aware of it at the time, I think the end result will be the law won't care.
Ignorance of a conflict of interest is not an excuse for...
Yes, that's what I believe. True, not a conflict that's sort of one of those, we've talked about them in here before, sort of an appearance of impropriety. I'm talking about if you have a disqualifying event based upon a spousal or some sort of a familial relationship, and you may not have been aware of it. I don't think the law, if there was a challenge to a zoning by a neighbor who says you had a conflict, and the answer from you is I didn't know I had it, I don't think the court will care whether you knew it or not. If there is truly a disqualifying conflict, I don't think the court would.
But probably the best way, to discover if you have a conflict of interest is to identify all the parties affiliated with an application.
That would seem reasonable.
Would that be proper?
That would seem reasonable.
So you should... because I've thought a lot about that, and I've kind of brought that up a few times, and somewhere along the line, maybe some point in time, we can, when somebody's presenting an application to the Planning Commission, I think it should be accompanied by a rezoning affidavit package explaining who the parties are so that we don't run the risk of having a conflict of interest.
And this is where you get into that balancing issue, because on the one hand, we have ethical duties, and then we have duties under the UDC. And on the one hand, we can't make, we're supposed to make land use decisions and recommendations based upon the public policy of land use. On the other hand, to the extent we have ethical obligations, we're supposed to make those based upon who is in fact impacted by those land use decisions. And so we have to keep those allegiances clear, but yeah, the point's well taken.
Okay, good. I might bring that up and some, maybe put it on the agenda or something to discuss it next meeting or something.
Madam Chair, unless there are any more questions from me, there is one other topic, but I want to defer to Mr. Brown on that. That is the extent of my bullet point cheat sheet.
I'm sticking on a theme of training, an update on training. For 2013, we have $700 that we can dedicate to the Planning Commission for training. So that's 140 a member. My advice is don't wait till, if you want to spend it, don't wait till December. Contact us soon. That kind of stuff needs to go through purchasing and checks need to clear and all that stuff or I can actually get it on this year's budget. We have the email that recently went out, I think from last month, about a class coming up soon through UGA that was $95 or $105, so cover that if you're interested. If one particular member is not interested in doing something this year, or wants to coordinate with another member so they can go to something more expensive, that's fine. Just contact me or contact Vanessa and coordinate with us and we'll work it out and we'll get you signed up for what you need to get signed up for.
Is it possible for us to, I know the Board of Commissioners has done this before and a lot of other organizations have done it, but they have a retreat for a night or two away from everything so we can all kind of bond together and have some education, at maybe Stone Mountain or some conference center that's close by, and just have an educational conference where we have somebody come in and speak to us, or maybe a couple of people come in and speak on a couple of different topics. Is that something that maybe we could, I want to run a flagpole and see if the planning department is interested in supporting the Planning Commission on a retreat of some sort, not even if it's at their own expense. I mean, it's not trying to get to spend money.
I would, if the Planning Commission came to me and said that's what they wanted, I would support it and try and make it happen. We're not going to pull that off for $700, but it's something we could talk about and something we could work on. Maybe it's something that we try to work into future year's budget, or something individuals want to approach the commissioner and ask for some kind of budget transfer to make happen. You're right. Years ago, maybe 2002, sometime around then, the Board of Commissioners had one like that, where they just dedicated about 2 days to trying to set a vision of where they wanted to head and what they wanted to accomplish.
I'm just thinking along the lines of basically what we've just heard is a lot of what we do is pretty serious business, and this would be a way to get that funneled into our heads, you know, and help us, you know. And I know that I could probably use a lot of more information about, you know, the Planning Commission, so I'd get a better commissioner. And I think that would be a pretty good way to do it, because it would be intent, so.
If you want to do it, just be mindful, you know, the Open Meetings Act still applies, so you still have the notice requirements. I've seen it done in the North Georgia Mountains before. They'll go rent them a cabin and go up there, and inevitably there'll be a member of the press, Alyssa, that'll go along with them to hang out and watch what they do. So that should be a blast. But you know, that's an opportunity too. You know, I talked about that notion of a culture. and the notion of trying to engender a culture. So, I mean, there is some value to it. The Board of Commissioners hasn't done it in a while. Has it really been that long, 2002, you think?
I think that's about when we did it.
I mean, I think Cherokee County did it more recently than that, and, you know, agencies all across the state do it. Just try to get away.
So is that something that we should discuss at a future work session, or how would you like us to approach that?
Before I went upstairs with that kind of request, I need to hear loud and clear that the Planning Commission as a whole wanted it. So yeah, I'd recommend you have it on a future work session agenda, talk about it in detail, and if the Planning Commission as a whole wants it, give me some clear marching orders on what to take upstairs and try to fight to get you.
Is that something that only I'm interested in, or
I don't object to discussing that at a work session and hear what everybody has to say and let everybody have input.
Do we need to make that in the way of a motion to put it on the agenda at a work session, or is that maybe you can put it on our next work session?
No. We'll find three of us.
We usually put stuff on the pre-cash bucket and stuff on the agenda. Possible. We'll bring it up next meeting.
Thank you.
That's it.
Are you done too, Tom?
I am.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Do you need me for the next discussion on compensation?
I don't think we do. Thanks. Thank you, Ken.
Right. Thank you all very much. Appreciate it.
The next thing on the agenda is discussion of Planning Commission compensation. Commissioner Moses, you want to get on there?
Yeah, and I appreciate y'all hearing me out on this.